Welcome everyone to the extra meeting we're having in February. And just to remind you, we've got a meeting tonight and then we've got a meeting next Thursday night. And in between that, we've also got the Ignite tour that's going to be in Sydney next Wednesday and Thursday. So busy time in February, not normally this busy in February, but and also, if you happen to be in Melbourne, there, Jeff Holland, who's going to be out for the Ignite tour, is going to be speaking in Melbourne on Monday, the 11th. And I think he's also doing a talk in Sydney on the 14th. So if you're wanting to catch up with any of those guys, it'll be a good opportunity to do that. So again, just our organizers, Martin, Dan, Renee, Wagner, and myself. And tonight we have Eldert talking about lessons from the API management trenches. So let me swap screens now and let him get started. Okay, here we go. Yep, we can see. We can see your screen.
Let me just
over to you.
Thank you. Let me just quickly get this away. Oh, this one go. There we go. Okay. So welcome everyone. Thank you for having me tonight. Thank you, Bill, for having me over. Was really looking forward to this. So here we go. So first, a little bit about myself. I'm Eldert Grotenboer. There we go. I come from Netherlands, so I'm actually on vacation here. So of course, what you do on vacation is do a webinar, or as I will be doing in a couple of weeks, do a meetup in Auckland. So I'm a work from Motion 10, a company from Netherlands, about 130 people at the moment. I work as a cloud solution architect. Next to that, I'm also Microsoft MVP. I like to blog, write books, do these kind of talks. Basically anything that has to do with the community. I like to share my knowledge, like to learn from others. And if you want to get in contact with me, you can always reach out to me on Twitter. So send me a message or whatever if you want to. So before we go into API management, let's first have a look at APIs. So why do we want to manage these APIs? So if we look at the growth of APIs, so I got this from the programmable web. There are a couple of other like these, and these look into the public APIs that are available. Now, I don't know if these numbers are completely correct. They go up to 2017 or something like that. So probably the SOLJAS have been growing on. But as you can see, APIs have become really important lately. And this just keeps on growing. And like I said, this is the public APIs. So this doesn't take into account the private APIs, which will there be a lot more of. So yeah, there are a lot of APIs out there. And so why are these APIs so important to us? So there are a couple of different things you can look at here. So mobile enablement. So it's about enabling mobile devices to work with the latest data, be in a safe environment where you can make sure that your devices are authorized, don't overload your systems, but you can still expose the data, those processes to your partners on mobile devices or in your partner ecosystem. So as we all probably know, there are still a lot of legacy backends out there. A lot of databases, ERP systems, things like that, that we are working with, but that we might want to expose in a more safe, secure environment, in a modernized environment. So that's also where we can use APIs as well. So we can place an API on top of that, have a nice modern interface for that data or for those processes and work from there. We can, of course, also make money from our APIs. So we can actually package our APIs into tiers where you can ask money. For example, you can have a free sample, like 5 calls per minute. And if you want to do more, then you have to start paying. And of course, also for our own business. So we, like I said, we've got a lot of legacy stuff still around. Of course, we are trying to build new stuff, but legacy stuff still will be there for a while. So we can actually expose that to our internal business users as well. And we can put out a catalog of APIs so they know actually what they can use, what's out there, which data they can use there. So yeah, there's a lot of value from bringing in these APIs. So a nice quote from Gartner from 2017 that I found. So APIs are really about digital strategies, digital transformation. Your APIs are driving your digital transformation and making sure that you actually can use all the data, all those processes that you have, actually use them to transform your company, your business. So with that, let's look, have a look at API management. So when we have all these APIs around, then we will run into some challenges that we have to face. So first of all, discoverability. So we have all these APIs out there, but how are people supposed to know that which APIs are available there and how they can call these APIs, how they work? And also the onboarding. So, okay, they found our APIs, but how are they going to start using them? How do they know how to call them? How they can they start? Because of course we want to have these probably at least want to have these in a secure way. So they probably will need some kind of key to be able to call them. We might have some extra additional security on top of there. So we also need to make sure that our APIs are protected enough for what we want them to be protected. So some APIs might just be open for the whole world. Some might just require a key, but for some, we might actually say, okay, maybe we need some certificates on there or other methods of authentication and security. Of course, we want to know what's going on with our APIs. We want to make sure that we know when they are down, when they are running into trouble, also who's calling them. And we want to be able to manage this lifecycle of our APIs. So new APIs are being built, so we want to expose those. Old APIs are being torn down, so we want to make sure they have the right path to the new APIs. And with all this, API management can help us. And during this session, I will be diving into this, how the API management does this. So first, have a look at how API management is built up. So API management has a couple of different components that we are using. So of course, you got your APIs in the backend, which can be either on Azure, outside of Azure, can be serverless, can be anything basically, as long as an API that's exposed. And we have got our developers that are creating these APIs, and we will probably have API managers that are actually exposing these APIs. So that can be the same group of people, but they can actually be different people. So API management has different tools for different personas here. And these the API managers and developers probably want to abstract the APIs. We got a lot of different APIs. Maybe we don't want to expose the APIs one-on-one to all the users. Maybe we want to have some operations that are not exposed, especially when you're talking to partners. Then you might say, okay, you have a limited set of data that we want to expose to these partners. Maybe you want to make a facade, so we have different APIs in the backend, expose a single API in the frontend. We want to be able to protect those APIs, so we'll make sure that only the people that are allowed to call them and can actually call them. We can manage the lifecycle here, monitor and measure on them, onboard those developers, and also monetize from those APIs. On the other side, we have our app developers, so the consumers of these APIs. We are building the third-party applications, or maybe even the first-party applications, because these app developers might also be in your own business. They might actually be developers also on the other side. So they're developing those APIs and consuming those APIs from their other APIs. And so those consumers are more interested in making sure they can discover those APIs, learn how to use them, actually be able to get access to them, of course, try them out, get help when they run into problems. And they want to be able to start quickly, but also with their own tooling. So of course, there's a lot of tooling out there. You can build on .NET, Python, Node.js. And those developers will probably want to build in their own language and with their own tooling. So what API management does, it brings in three components. So on the left, we got our developer portal, which is where our consumers will be looking up the APIs that we expose to them. So here they can see which APIs they can use. They can create a subscription on it so they can actually start using them. They can start with a nice try it out kind of environment where they can actually just say, okay, show me this API, show me what I should put in here. And they can try out before actually implementing this in the open applications. And finally, they will find a nice piece of code on the bottom that they can just copy and paste into their own code. In the middle, we show our gateway, and this is where our backend APIs are actually communicating with the consumer APIs. So the consumer APIs, which are on the top, will just call the gateway, and the gateway will make sure it's routed to the correct APIs in the backend. And finally, on the right side, we got our Azure portal, which is where the API managers and developers will actually be exposing our APIs. And with that, we can use API management to start creating products. So as you can see here on the bottom, we have all our different APIs, which might be on Azure, on the premises, maybe even in AWS or anything like that. And we'll put API management on top of that and create a facade on top of that or a proxy to those APIs. So our consumers won't be calling those APIs directly. Instead, they will be calling API management. API management will be doing a whole lot of stuff on security, policies, things like that. And finally, passed on to the backend. And with that, our consumers can create their own applications around that to show off, to use those capabilities that they need in their product. So they can be different for different consumers, of course. And we can also make sure different consumers can see different APIs on API management. So why API management? It's a single point of entry. So our consumers don't have to know about our backend services. Instead, they only have to know about API management. They get a single endpoint on top of there, and they can just use that endpoint to call those APIs. We can make a facade, so we can actually have different endpoints on our backend, exposed as a single API on the front end. We can add capabilities, so we can use policies to actually add capabilities, add restrictions on top of there. So we can make these APIs smarter. For example, one that is frequently used is caching. Building your own caching system can be kind of a trouble. With API management, you get caching out of the box. It's basically a flick of the switch and it will be on. And you can just implement that on those existing APIs, making them smarter that way. There are various kinds of security you can put up on top of there, thanks to API management. So even if you have an open web service on the backend, you can still make sure it's secured on the front end so that our different consumers will have to make sure they are authenticated, authorized to use those APIs. And with a developer portal, we can make sure that our consumers can quickly get started. And finally, we can, of course, want to get insights on that. So we can use API management to see, okay, who's calling these APIs? How often are they being called? When are they being called? Are there any issues? So now let's switch over to the actual from the trenches part. So API management is basically what most of our customers will be implementing at the first time they are starting with Azure. Many of our customers come from on-premise systems, oftentimes with Bistock or something like that, and are migrating to the cloud. So API management makes it really easy for them to expose those existing services they have via a new modern interface to the cloud. And one of the first questions that always comes up is, okay, we are used to a DTAP experience, so we have different services for different environments. How are we going to do this in Azure? This is actually more than just for API management. This comes up for everything that we build in Azure. So my experience is that we mostly will use something like this. So we have a non-production environment subscription and we have a production subscription. This is not the only way you can do this. I've seen many different scenarios here, where from ranging from every department or even every project or every implementation having their own subscription, all the way up to having one single subscription for everything. But this is what we implement at most of our clients. So we have a non-production subscription, where we have development, test, and acceptance, and then a different production subscription that's completely hammered down, where all the production is running. And so for API management, what we basically do is have one single instance in the non-production environment for development, test, and acceptance, but have different products for those three different environments. So next, the taxonomy of API management. So we have our APIs with the operations on the APIs. And we have our users on the other side. So those users will be wanting to use those APIs, we will want to call them. But we don't want to give them direct access to those APIs, of course, because that's why we get API management in between there. So what we will do is set up groups. And think of this as the same way as you would set up groups in your Azure Active Directory. So users, which can be developers or applications, and you will group them together inside the group. For example, if Contoso is our client, which is consuming our APIs, I would give different identities for those users in to our Active Directory, maybe the applications as well. And then have one group, Contoso developers, for example. Then we would place a product on top of there. So a product is basically a set of APIs that are grouped together. So I might have a group product, Contoso Finance, which contains all different finance products that Contoso is around allowed to use. And I might have another product, Contoso Healthcare, for example. And then I can have assign access to those groups, to those products on group level. So I don't assign the individual users, but instead I assign the group on top of there. And then those users in that group can get a subscription on top on the product. So they can say, okay, they will see which products, which APIs and in the products they are allowed to see. And then they can say for each API that is interesting for them, they can grab a subscription on the product. So this is how we normally also set it up. So you could say, okay, I will assign my user directly to those products, but that's not what we do normally. We'd like to have that group in between there. So we can just say, okay, for Contoso, all these users are in this Contoso group. And when, for example, they are no longer allowed to call that those health insurance or those health insurance APIs, then we can just say, okay, we delete the this product group reference. And we know for sure that no one can call them from Contoso anymore. So we'll look at properties. So properties are basically named value properties. So as you would just key value pairs, basically. And within API management, you can have these properties and share them within your API management instance. So you can use these from your various policies to basically just set up attributes. And this allows to decouple your properties from your implementation. So for example, if you have a username, a password, or something like an backend URL that you want to be able to change on the fly, this will be your place. Especially when you start sharing them across multiple policies, this is really nice to have them in single location where you can just update them and use them from there. So like I said, it enables a single point of change. And these are environment specific. So what this means is they are in your side of your instance, your API management instance. So in our case, we always have two instances, one in the production, one non-production. So each of these would have their own properties. On the other hand, you could also say, would like to use Key Vault. Now we can't use Key Vault at this moment for key value properties, so we can't, but we can use them for certificates. Now, of course, a Key Vault would be on a subscription level. So if you would have multiple API management instances in your subscription, you would use them Key Vault for all of these. And like I said, you can just use certificates at this moment. I'm thinking they will allow for the key value properties as well from Key Vault in the future. But for now, we can just use them for subscriptions, certificates, sorry. And it allows for decoupling services from those certificates. So after you will see you have those root certificates or something like that, that are based for all your different APIs. This allows you to use them in a very safe way, allows you to auto-rotate them. And just there's a nice integration in between this. You can just say, okay, if you have to set up your own certificates on your API instance, you just point to your Key Vault and it will just grab those certificates from there. And whenever they are renewed in your Key Vault, it will just auto-rotate them into API management as well. So let's have a look at one of our customer scenarios. So for this customer, you have created a facade. So this customer was one of the big mobile phone companies. So they sell subscriptions, they sell mobile phones, and they have a pretty large backend. So I've put in three here, but in reality, there was about, I think, over 1,000 different services, APIs, things that we were calling there. Now, our consumer were the stores. So the stores would actually want to sell these subscriptions to their clients or those phones. They would call the different APIs at this company. Of course, we didn't want to have them to expose all these APIs directly to the stores because one, not all of them were very secure. These are web servers sometimes that were 10 years old, we're not had no authentication on them all. Others couldn't really be trusted to be at the loads. So if you put too much load on there, it would also fail. And there were just a lot of different servers that they would call in different languages, different mechanisms to call them. So what we wanted is to have API management in front of there to create a facade on top of there. And what this allowed to do is for the client here, to just call the API, expose API management. So different operations on there. So create subscription, cancel subscriptions, get subscription status, things like that. And by calling, because it's now just different operations, it's really easy for them to say, okay, we're now going to create a subscription. In the backend, that might call an API, it might call a logic app, might call a function, might call a web service. They don't care about that in the front end, right? They just want to say, okay, I want to create a subscription. So let's have a look. So what I did for this is I've created this subscription, this API in API management called Lessons from the API Management Transits Facade. So I've got three different operations on top of this. And if you look here at all operations, you'll see I don't have an endpoint set here. So I'm going to say each operation will get its own endpoint. So for example, if you look at create order, what I did here is I've set up, you can't really see, but this is a logic app, which has a really nice experience to place these into API management. You can just say you want to go as resource and you can browse your Azure resources to find your different logic apps. I also got a get inventory here. And this one is actually using an API for Mockable, so just an API out on the web. And my last one is my subscription status. And for this, I call an API Azure function. So as you can see, very different APIs that I'm exposing here, all with their own authentication methods, all with their own ways that you have to call them. But for our client, he just can say, okay, I've got this endpoint, so API management, Azure API.net, and I just have different operations on here. So if I want to create an order, I will send in this order, and this will be used in Logic App to place this order into my, let's see here, and this will place this order into Cosmos DB. Let me just quickly see if this will load. Yep, there we go. And of course, this may be just Logic App, really easy to develop, really easy to maintain. There we go. So it just receives a HTTP request, it updates it in Cosmos DB, and finally gives back a response. And this response is then given back to our client. And I see it sends out the 200 OK. Now, so this for the order. Of course, you also got some for the inventory. So as you can see, same mechanism again. We just, let me also switch here to the headers. So as you will see, they only have to provide a subscription key. Same here, they can use the same subscription key here. They can send it in. And again, with subscription status, just the same, they can send in order ID. They can send in subscription key sent. Now in the backend, these all use different security mechanisms. They use different ways to call them, but the client does not need to know about this. The client only needs to know how to call this endpoint with different operations and with a single subscription key used for authentication. So really easy for them. So next, let's look at making our APIs smarter. So there's a policy for that. You will see various policies calling by here on the site. And so API Manager comes with a lot of out-of-the-box common functions. So policies. So you can do something like, okay, I want to set a header, or I want to authenticate with using basic authentication, something like that. But you can also do some more complex stuff, like do some caching, logging something to event hubs, things like that. You can limit the calls. And you can actually create pipelines using your policies. So you can actually pass the output from one policy into the next policy. You can even mutate your messages. Now, I will be careful with this. You can do some, you can actually do some complex transformations inside your API management. But to me, that would not be the best place to do this. So I would rather, if I go to complex transformations, I would probably use Logicap, maybe use an XSLT or Liquid transformation from the integration accounts. But you can do, you could with Liquid transform as well. But like I said, make sure the, or think about this, I wouldn't do complex transformations here. You can do this on inbound and outbound messages. So you can do this both coming from the client, but also the response back from the backend. And you can implement error handling here as well. And finally, you have different scopes where you can do this. So if you look at the different scopes, we got scopes like, you got scopes that are global. So for your entire environment, you can scope it on the product. So you can actually say, okay, for this product, which is connected, of course, to the groups that we saw previously, you can say, okay, for this partner, I only want them to call this API, for example, 5 times a minute, where another partner might actually be allowed to call them 10 times a minute, or with different tiers that you have in the hyper throughput tier, that you have another product that you can actually say, okay, I've got this for 1,000 times per minute. You can also do the API itself, and you can even go as deeply as the operation. So what you would do on the global scale level was probably something like logging, maybe setting up cores. Whereas on product, like I said, you will probably do some rate limiting or quotas there. The API itself, you can do something like authentication, checking a YOT header or something like that. And on the operation, you would probably do something like caching, changing the message, things like that. You can also do some, so like I said, you get various out-of-the-box operations, but you can also create your own policies. It's done using C# snippets. They only can access, have read-only access to your context. So you cannot change your context. You can just read from your context. And you only have a limited amount of .NET types that you actually use. But it does allow you to create very dynamic policies. So you can actually have lookups and decide from whatever is coming in, what you want to do next. So for example, let's have a look at this. So what we do here, we have a variable that we set with the body size. So we can look up the content length from the headers, and we set that in a variable. Next, we use this variable to check, okay, is this above a certain size? If it's below the size, so in the when, we won't change anything. So we'll just call the API that we configured from the portal. But if it is above this size, we will actually change the URL and the backend service. So for example, you think of this as if you want to send something to a service bus in the backend, but if the message is above 1 megabyte when you're on the premium tier, or above 64K, I think, for the standard tier, you might actually say, well, I won't be able to send this to the service bus. Instead, I will send it to a storage account. So things like that you can create pretty easily, as you can see. And it's really powerful because you can really, depending on what's coming in, you can really make decisions and create your own policies. So let's have a look at that. You have another customer scenario here. And this is for another client of ours where we implemented It's for one of the large container terminals in Rotterdam. And what they wanted, so they have two different, I explained two different here. So they expose Service Bus 3 API management. Of course, Service Bus, you can call with REST. So you can actually use REST to place messages on Service Bus. But they didn't want to have this exposed to the client. So when working with Service Bus, of course, you can use SDKs, but this client didn't want to use that. They want to use REST calls. And when you use REST calls to Service Bus, you have to create a REP token. You have to do some calculations for SDS tokens. And yeah, it's a pretty complex thing if you are not used to this. On the other hand, they also have a WCF service. So this is, say there are some old service still in the background. But again, the clients want to use REST to call this. So they had to make sure that it was converted from REST frontend to a WCF backend with SOAP. So what you can do here, over here, and go back to my API. So I created another API for this. And in this API, I got two different operations. First is to get the status of the containers. Like I said, this is a big container terminal back in Rotterdam. And what happened here? So they started with just exposing this API publicly. But what would happen is that they would some of their clients would build scrapers that would just be keep on calling this API. So they ended with very large costs for very little information for the actual clients that was calling them. So they did a couple of things here. So as you can see, I've got different policies set up here on my inbound processing. I can add another policy through here. Or what we will go to now, we will go actually in the code view of this policy and look at what I set up here. So what I did, let me check. Where is it? Here. So what I did is set up a rate limit by key. So now when I have my subscription key, so each user can only call it 5 times every 300 seconds. So that already took care of a lot of that traffic. What I also want to do is make sure that they were authenticated, not just by their, by their subscription key. I also added some additional authentication there with basic authentication, just here. Now, this is the SOAP backend. So this is actually a SOAP service. And when you import the SOAP service into API management, you can just say, okay, here's my WSDL, and it will build up the request for you and the response. You can also do this yourself. They use Liquid templates for this. But I just use the import here. It will set up SOAP action on there because of course you have to have SOAP action to call this. It will make sure it's transformed to XML. And here you will see that it transforms the body to an XML body. So you got your incoming, let's see, oh, this is the outbound. So this is the other way. So we'll actually grab that response and transform it back into a JSON. And the other one is our Service Bus. And what I did here, so here I created a custom policy. As you will see, I got some resources here. So I got my resource URI for my Service Bus queue. I got the SES key and SES name. And here I have a snippet of simple simple C# code where I just calculate the SES token that I will need to send. So for anyone who has ever done this, you will just need to create a shared X signature that you pass in with your call. And finally, this will be called on this backend. So this means that even though we are using API management in front of Service Bus, in front of SOAP web service, our client still only has to know how to do this REST call. Again, we got our simple, endpoint on API management. And what we pass in here is our subscription key, of course. We pass in our authentication because this is one way added some authentication. We pass in the body So we say, okay, which container do we want to get the ETA for? And we send, when we send this out, it will actually go back to our SOAP environment, which I've got here on mockable. Let me switch over. So in the meantime, let me just go over here. So we already got our response back, so our ETA, and here we should see in our logging, and where's my logging? Back. Soap. View logs, there we go. And you actually see that it has been called here. Oh. And it responds with, there we go. It responds with a piece of XML, so nice SOAP message. But our client will get back just the ETA from in a JSON format from over REST. So once our client, really simple, can just call REST endpoint. We go to WCF service with SOAP and it converts back to JSON within API management. Now for the service bus one, same principle. We call a REST endpoint. And of course we expose that REST endpoint from service bus. So it will just go to service bus and we should get our message here. So receive. And it should peak. Receive now. It's still working. There we go. And as you can see, it received our message, which we just sent over API management to the REST APIs from Service Bus into Service Bus to queue. So very powerful to be able to do this kind of things. So let's have a look at security. You already mentioned this is an important part for our APIs, of course. And like we saw in the beginning, we have different parts of API management that we need to expose or that we need that we are exposing. So we got our developer portal where our consumers are. And those will be using logging in with username and password. This can be a local username and password, but you can also, of course, use Auth2. To use Microsoft account, Google account, Facebook, all that kind of stuff. So they can still use their own account while logging into your developer portal. The gateway, so this is the actual service. So on the front end, you can use a header key, like we just saw. You can also use OAuth, OpenID. You can use client certificates. And you can do some filtering with IP filtering and rate limits and quotas. On the backend side, we can use basic authentication. We can use certificates again, shared secrets, and we can use again use IP filters, or we can actually call into a VNet or a network security group, although this is only on the premium tier and developer tier. And finally, our API management developers, they are working in the portal, of course, so they use their Azure account to log into the portal. And you can use role-based access control to set up what they are allowed to call or not call. Then hybrid. Well, of course, like I said, often we are still working with legacy environments that might be still on-premise. And you may want to set up hybrid connectivity. Using the premium tier, you can actually use VNets for this. So you can actually call through a VNet. You can place the API management in front of the VNet in the public space and call over the VNet, go into your private space, or you can actually place it into your private space as well and have everything within your VNets. This is a pricey option though, because like I said, you will need a premium tier. So that means that you will be paying, I don't know the exact amount of, but it will be something like 1200 euro or dollars per month. So of course, there it has advantages. If you can, if you have are running a big operation, this is no problem. But some of our clients are smaller clients. They are only have a few APIs that they want to expose. So then this money is too much. So you can actually do this in other ways as well. And one of them is using Azure Relay. So Azure Relay is just a component that you implement in your on-premise service. And then you can use API management to call this to Azure Relay, which exposes a public endpoint, which then routes into your local endpoint. So this is another way that you can set this up, or you can use IP whitelisting. So you can just say, because API management has a static IP address, except for the consumption plan, which is recently announced, is now in public preview, I think, or maybe just got G8, I'm not sure. But this user does not have a static IP, so they will have to know that. But for the other tiers, so standard, basic, and premium, they have a static IP address that you can use, and you can whitelist that on your firewall. Let's have a look at scalability, because of course we're working with APIs, so we want to be scalable, because we never know when will these APIs be called, when we might have surges. And scaling can be done on two levels. So we can scale up, so we can actually say, okay, we want to go to a higher tier, where higher tiers have more throughput capacity. Or we can scale out, so this is available on the standard and the premium tier, where, okay, I want to add more instances. And you can also do scaling on multi-region. So this also, again, premium tier. So as you can see, premium tier does offer a lot of extras. Where you can say, okay, I've got a standard unit with one unit, but if I want to scale up multi-region, I will have to upgrade to my, so I can scale up to two units on standard. But once I want to go multi-region, I will actually have to say, okay, so in this case, multi-region, when we only have the standard, the other region would actually call into our Northern European region, which would mean they would have latency, things like that. So if we switch to premium, we now have the capabilities to do multi-region. So we can actually say we have our North European units, but we have a remote unit as well in Central US. So now our Central US customer can actually call into API management in our Central US region. Now, of course, if our backend is still only in North Europe, that won't help that much, because it will have a caching, of course. So if you do some caching, it will be a lot faster. But if they still have to call to the backend, it still won't be that fast either. So what you want to do is make sure that you have move your backend, copy your backend also to that other region. So this has major advantages, because now that Central US region actually has low latency because they are calling to their own region. But it will have impact on your whole architecture. So this is something that you really have to think about. How do you want to do this? There we go. Now, let's have a look at some monitoring stuff. So API management, like any other service on Azure, has different levels when you do your monitoring. Of course, you can monitor your infrastructure with your activity log, which just monitors, okay, who has, for example, created an API, who has deleted something. So it really is on the infrastructure level. Then you have your diagnostic logs on your guest level, application level. So this is more about, okay, how is my service running within Azure? And of course, you got your application logs as well, which is more about, okay, how is my APIs in this case running? And API management comes with a lot of out-of-the-box integration for Application Insights and Azure Monitor. So you can actually just flick a switch, tell where your destination Application Insights or Azure Monitor is. You can set up sampling rate, because if you have high throughput APIs, you probably don't want to log everything, because of course it has some impact on your performance. So you can actually just say, I want to scale sample 10% or 25% of my messages. So I at least have an overview about how this is doing. But you can also say, okay, I will always want to log errors. And if you have some additional settings, okay, do you want to add some errors? Do you only want to have a certain amount of the body? And this is just built in. So you do, like I said, just flick off the switch and it will be logging for you. So very powerful. Then we got some telemetry in there as well. They are at the moment migrating this from the old portal, from the old published portal to the Azure portal. And this will help you give insights in, okay, how are my requests running? How long are they, how are the response times? How much data is being transferred, things like that. But also things like, okay, where are they calling this from? Which APIs are being called? Which operations? Who is calling this? So which subscriptions or which users? Things like that. So you can really get very detailed knowledge about how your APIs are being used. You can also log to event ops. This is a policy that you would implement, as you can see down here. And when you implement this policy, you just say, okay, to which event hub do you want to log? And then all your messages are actually being logged to event hubs, where you can do things like use machine learning or use big data. So even get more insights into your APIs. Microsoft also provides a nice Power BI template. And this gives even more information in what's going on. So this goes way beyond the standard telemetry that you have. This really gives a lot of information. I think there are like 7 or 8 different tabs on this, which give information like this. And you can just really drill down into, okay, how my API is behaving, how are they being used? So this is a Power BI solution template, like I said. It provisions the resource automatically. So they use Power BI, of course, they use Event Hubs, they use Stream Analytics. So this is being provisioned for you. Do keep in mind, this does cost about $10 per day at the moment. So it's, again, not the cheapest, but it does provide a lot of insights for you. Like I said, Event Hubs, Stream Analytics, Azure SQL, and of course, this is really scalable because it's very important because you are placing something inside of your policies. So you don't want to have any performance or performance hits or bringing down your APIs. It's really easy to get started. You just download this and you run it. It's open source, so you can also look into how they are doing this. You can adjust it for yourself. And you can get it from here. These slides will be shared afterwards, so you can just go over here. So let's have a look at lifecycle management. This is always also big, important, very important piece of your solutions. How do you actually get them from your development environment to your production environment? I'm a big fan of ARM templates myself. Every customer that we come to, we use ARM templates. But of course, you can also use something like CLI or whatever your Terraform or whatever you fancy. But what we do is set it up like this. So we have our service templates, which is basically about the instance of the API management, products, users, groups, things like that. And then we have the API templates. And these are the templates for the APIs that our developers are creating. So what developers do, they fork this and they start to develop their own APIs, create the API definitions. From those definitions, they create their API templates. And these are then checked in as ARM templates. They then do a pull request, the API publishers, which are often another group. For most of my clients where I'm actually working at, it would be me. But as I go away, of course, I make sure someone else also knows how to do this. And they will make sure, okay, those API templates they created, those ARM templates, are they validating? Are they actually doing what they are supposed to do? Things like that. And then we can just use those ARM templates with Azure DevOps to push them to the different stages. So development, maybe testing, acceptance, and finally to production. So version and revisions. So when we have our APIs, they might look something like this. So we have our service instance, we have our API, and there are different operations. Now what happens if you want to create a new version of this? So with API management, we have 2 different options. We can actually create a new version, which means there will have to be a new version running next to the old version in the backend. And this is for breaking changes. So we have a V1, where, for example, we have the days operation, and we have V2, where we remove this operation. So this is a breaking change. So you want to have your clients that are still using this days operation to be able to continue using this. So if you in API management, you can actually create a new version and say, okay, my new version has this new API in the backend and points to that. And you can also create revisions, and revisions are more about non-breaking changes. So for example, we can say, okay, we are now going to add a new revision, which adds the new operation sessions. So this is just adding a new operation, so nothing to anyone who's using this. And you can just do this in place. So you can actually work on this and say, okay, for example, here we are working on revision 4. Revision 3 is still current. So everyone that's calling our APIs and not calling the explicitly calling revision 4 will not see this yet. And as soon as we say, okay, we are done, we'll just move the revision to the new revision. And from then on, everyone will see it. Mocking is also very important when we are working with APIs, because you want to have your clients working with them as soon as possible, especially on projects where you have different parties working together to build a complete end-to-end scenario. You don't want them to wait till the actual API is completely developed and for before they can use it. So with API management, you can actually create a mock. So of course, you will have to define the contract first. So that's something that you always do at the start of the project. Create a contract, how this API is going to look like. And then we just place that into a mock. So our client can actually start calling API management and can start getting responses. So this allows them to check, okay, how's our authentication working? How are our policies working? All those things without the API being there in the backend. And once the API is done, we can just point to the endpoint of the API, switch off mocking, and it will work as supposed to be. Now, we got this developer portal, which out of the box doesn't look that pretty. It's okay, but it's nothing special. Let me just quickly show this, because I didn't do that. So if you look at the developer portal, it will just be a standard developer portal that will be there for everyone. So use the standard Azure, how do you say, the Azure template, Azure layout. I will come back to this in just a moment. Ah, there we go. So as you can see, this would be your customer, your consumers will be seeing when they go to the portal. Now, this is fine if you are not that worried about just a standard template, but some of our clients actually wanted to have their own logo on there, have it completely in their house layout. Oh, not print. So what you can do is actually customize the portal. So you can use CSS, use images, things like that to actually update the layout of the portal. And that way you can just have a customized portal that's completely in your own house style, and then you can present that to your developer, to your consumers in a nice way. You can even bring your own portal as well. So for this, you have to have your own website where you do your own authentication, things like that. And you have to set some URLs in the developer portal configuration. So what happens when you do this? When someone tries to log in, you will actually be forwarded to your own delegation page and to your own login. They can log in here or they can sign up, and they will be sent back to the developer portal to check, okay, which APIs can I use? Which products do I have? Things like that. And this gets really important when you want to start monetizing on your APIs, because the Azure developer portal has no way to implement something like payments for your different tiers. So if you want to have a basic tier and tier for which actually costs money, you have to do this in your own website. So that is what you would do this for. So almost time. So this is my last demo as well. We are running nicely. So what I will be showing here quickly is how do we use those ARM templates for our different clients. So as you will see, this is for one of clients. I've created an API management platform and API management for the APIs themselves. So if you look at the platform, of course, for example, I've got my instance. So I've got a nice template for the instance. I got one for products. Well, you name it, for APIs themselves. And these will be placed into a storage account using Azure DevOps. So this is my pipeline that will be deploying the whenever something changes in this repository. So I've got my API management, I got some other things in there as well, database service, things like that. And whenever something changes here, it will just start deploying this, but also copy those ARM templates to the storage account. So both my platform and my API templates. So what this allows my the developers to do is switch to this one, create link templates. And the link template basically uses another template to in a sort of orchestration to start different deployments after another. So in this case, I would deploy an API, which uses the API to JSON in my storage account. I would add a product to that API. Another product, let me see. I would add some tags. So as you can see, I'm just building up my complete API with my operations. It will be coming soon. So I've got my operations on here. So I'm just going to create my complete API using those templates that I created previously. So my developers just have to know, okay, what has to be on this API. So this operation, there's operation there, text like that. They say, okay, I want to use this. And for that, I have to set these different parameters. So they don't have to know how to create this kind of templates. They just have to know how to consume them. And that will then go to my DevOps pipeline. It will first do a build. Well, not a build, because we don't build anything with the ARM templates. We just validate them. So what I will do is I got some PowerShell here for getting the CESS token for that particular container they're in. And it will just validate my complete link template. It will finally publish this and go to my development pipeline. Once again, get a SES token because, of course, I'm saying here, this one, I'm using my template storage and get a SES token to actually say, okay, where do you have to get this template? And then here it will grab the template and start deploying it. And of course, let me go to my pipeline. Of course, it does this for different environments as well. So depending on which branch it's being checked in, so we use Git Flow for this. Depending on the branch where it's being checked in, it will kick off a different stage in our process. So almost done. So quick recap. So we use API management to abstract backend services. So we make sure that our consumers don't have to know about our backend. It could be running on premises, in Azure, in AWS. Our consumers don't care about that. They just want to call our APIs. So they have one single entry point where they can call this. We can transfer messages, transfer protocols. So as you saw, we got our REST to SOAP conversions. We can actually transfer our messages. We can add restrictions or capabilities. So we can actually say, okay, if you call this too many times, we will throttle you. Or you can say, we want a caching on this, we want to transform this, things like that. And most important, I think, we can actually gain very nice insights, governance, and analytics. So we can actually very control who can call our APIs. We can see who's calling them, how often they are being called, and what they are actually doing. So some resources, like I said, this will be shared as well. So you can just go to the different resources. So with that, I'd like to thank you. If you want to contact me, to reach out on Twitter, reach out on email. I've written various blog posts around this. So if you want to reach more about this, just let me know. And with that, I say thank you.
Thank you very much. Let me just change my screen back real quick. So basically, you should be seeing now the slide I put in there on the Ignite tour. And thank you very much, Eldip. Just a couple of slides here on the Ignite. And then one of our organizers is going to be at Ignite too. So Dan, just catch up with him if you happen to be at Ignite. Do we have any questions? If not, Elder's Conduct details are in there, and the recording will be up online in a couple of days, and I will tweet out the recording. So thank you very much.